Welcome, everyone. It's Nina Galway. I'm the educational support teacher here at school, and I also do parent ed during the year. And this is our first attempt at offering you some parent enrichment during the RISE program. And I thought I would start out with a look at temperament, basically because in all of the check-ins I've been having with parents, I can see a lot of the temperament piece popping out a little bit. Talked to some parents the other day. They were like, we have three kids and they're all approaching this so differently, working really great for one, working pretty well for the other, and not so well for the other one. And as they went and described a little bit, and I know the children fairly well, I realized that this was definitely temperament at work here. And the more challenging parts of temperament can pop out when we're under stress. So it makes sense to me that we're going to be bumping up against a bit of temperament during this time when rhythms have changed and children might feel a little more anxious. So I just thought I'd offer you a little overview of what temperament is. We'll look at the four basic temperaments that we work with in Waldorf education. And then next Wednesday, that's Wednesday the 22nd at 3:30, I'll be offering an open Zoom room if you'd like to come and have more conversation about this, or if you have any questions about what is offered here today. So let's dive in. First of all, I just wanted to do a quick overview of what is essential for us in education as Waldorf teachers. And this may be coming through, you know, as you're doing your lessons with the children, why we're doing it the way we're doing it and not just sort of setting up Zoom, you know, links, YouTube links for you to just get some work done. We're really looking at like still holding what's essential to us in education. And the first piece is the meeting of the children, really where they are neurologically, emotionally, honoring their development so that the curriculum is developmentally appropriate, which is why we're having the class teachers carry on with just giving the lessons because this is so important to us. And then secondly, bringing in the arts, which is very foundational to Waldorf education. And really that's because we honor that between the ages of 7 and 14, the emotional body is really being developed. And the way you reach and mold and encourage and fertilize the emotional body is through the arts. So the music and the drawing and keeping the handwork going and as best we can during this time is important to us. Bringing healthy movement, always, that it's important for the children to move in integrated ways to really help strengthen the senses for learning and also to integrate the neural pathways, that's done through movement. Movement obviously is also very good for relieving stress, so we highly recommend that the kids are getting out and moving, especially during this time. And then the other pieces, you know, relationship is very important, which is why it's not been easy for us as teachers to meet this time, in that we don't love doing this over screens, but we're really still trying to keep that connection going. And that knowing that the social and emotional part of education is as important as academics. So we know this is hard for the children and that their social world has been limited, but how to keep, you know, just those relationships now with you very open. This is why I've been encouraging parents not to worry so much about everything getting done, or, you know, that you're really looking at your own child and your relationship with your child and putting that strong emotional connection first before getting everything done. And then lastly, we as Waldorf educators take very seriously the child's temperament. We are always looking, watching, trying to understand the children, and temperament's a big part of that, because when we can begin to understand how to work with temperament, Our work becomes a lot easier. It's also a very big gift that we give to children when they can feel met and not, you know, sort of that there's something wrong with them because of their temperament. So it's really important to sort of get the flavors. And so what I'm going to do today is dive into the four temperaments. And then I'm going to stop the video and I'm going to offer separate videos for each of the temperaments so that you do not have to, you know, listen to the whole thing. If you'd rather you kind of have a sense of what temperament your child is and you want to just go to that temperament, that's wonderful. But at some point it's great if you can watch all of them, because your friends are eventually going to come over, and it's really nice to understand the different children that make up our classes. So what is temperament? Temperament is one of the earliest personality theories that have been around. It came out of ancient Greece. Hippocrates was one of the first people to bring this forward, and he believed that he saw that the differences in different types of people and how we approach the world was based in this physical constitution piece that is very evident from birth. Now, we don't always see an obvious temperament right at birth, but by the age of 7, usually you can really begin to sense what temperament that the child is, and this comes through their physical constitution. So we'll actually be looking as we go through the slides. I have pictures of the look of the temperament. There's kind of an overall look to it because it is body based. So it comes in with the child at birth. I like the way that he talked about it as being the canvas. It's sort of the basis of how a child is in the world. Personality is what's put on top of that. It's the paint. And that comes more, personality is born more out of than the environment and things that children are exposed to and how they're raised. So you're sort of looking at this innate quality they come in, and then it's overlaid with personality later on. So sometimes temperament's called the childhood ego, because before, you know, the ego at proper develops, which is really more around the age of 21, they'll live very deeply out of their temperament. And it has a lot to do with the activity level of the child, their initial reactions to things, like will they move towards or away certain things, their adaptability, how they adjust to change, which is why this is a good time to look at temperament. Their moods, are they a generally happy child or more generally moody, sad? And then also their focus levels, whether they're more focused or unfocused, can really have a lot to do with their temperament. So again, this is deeply at play between the ages of 7 and 14. So this applies to all the children in elementary school area. And as adults, you know, as we go through this, it's really wonderful to sort of identify your own temperament. And we do this by going back more to how we were in childhood, because temperaments transform. And we're going to be talking about that as we look at each temperament directly. How the transformation of that temperament happens, especially right in adolescence. So the basic rule for temperament is to go with it, to understand it and actually work with it. Knowing that it arises from the constitution, that it's nothing you can change. You can't say, gosh, I wish I had a happier child, if you have, you know, a child who's more on the introverted melancholic spectrum. Or you can't say, gosh, I wish my child would tone it down, if you have a more boisterous choleric child. This is really arises from their constitution, but we can learn to work with it, that it can be shaped. It just can't be changed. And, you know, the more that we actually can work with temperament, the more likely it is to loosen out of the more challenging aspects of it. So every temperament has a gift and every temperament has its challenges. But as adults can learn to work with the child's temperament, they allow that child to move more quickly into the gift part of the temperament. Again, the child's temperament kind of affects their behaviors. Again, it's like how they act, how they react to the world. It's not the why they react. That really comes more out of personality, you know, how you're treated, depending on your home life and so many factors is more the whys. This is the how they are. So again, understanding the strengths and weaknesses helps us then to help that child unfold through their temperament. So the four basic temperaments, and before we start, I want to say right away that we are not looking to put a child in a box to label them. We are really looking to some fundamental qualities that can help us understand them and sort of get into their shoes so that as they walk through the world, we can understand how they see things. So just really important that we don't go around typing people. And there's not one better or worse temperament. Every single temperament has its gift and every single temperament has its challenge. And if you want to go more deeply into this, the other study you can look into is the Enneagram. It's a much more refined look, although they don't equate that to temperament, but I've worked with the Enneagram very much in depth, and it's helped me even more to understand children and parents and myself and teachers. And so it can be a wonderful side study to this. It's called the Enneagram. Okay, the four temperaments. So we're going to start with the choleric. I'm using the animals from the Winnie the Pooh stories because they're great examples of the differences of the temperaments, and I'm sure he had an understanding of this when he did it. So the choleric is a rabbit. You remember in the stories, a very bossy, very energetic. The choleric, it has a fiery quality. The part of the body that they have the infinity with is the blood. So you'll see very hot, we call them hot-blooded children. You know them when you see them. And we'll go into their features more in depth when we talk about the choleric, but they're more on the extroverted side. They are boisterous. They have a lot of energy. Those red cheeks, they're very solid, solidly built. And, you know, they can be one of the more challenging children to raise, but incredibly wonderful adults. All of the temperaments are, but, you know, often the cholerics, parents of cholerics are like, wow, this is a lot. And it is a lot when they're little, but they do transform. The sanguines are sort of the classic, because the time of childhood is also a sanguine time of life. This is that playful, very, there's an affinity with air. So they're the lots of energy and, breath. So they're like the social butterflies. They flit from here to there. Whereas the choleric is more the, you know, steady, constantly energetic. These guys are the flitty ones. They're fairly easy, social butterflies, very light in their energy, usually very happy children. And again, we'll go into these more in depth as we go through each one. And then we have the melancholic. We're moving, so these two are more the extroverted temperaments, and now we move into the more introverted temperaments. The melancholic, don't love that term, but it's because I think there's kind of a negative connotation, but that's this inward child with the affinity with the bones. So they feel things all the way to their bones, affinity with the earth. There's sort of a heaviness that lands with these children. They're usually very more pale, thin-skinned, and they feel very deeply. So, and much more quiet than the other two. And then there's the phlegmatic, the Pooh Bear. And the phlegmatics are also much more inward, and they have less energy than the sanguine or choleric. Usually very easygoing, easy to raise. And their affinity is with the glandular system. So they tend to have a watery quality. As you will look at the photos coming up, and you'll see a little bit more baby fat or big cheeks later into childhood than other children. So I'm going to be now turning this off, and then you can click on the different temperament that you'd like to learn about. But I do think at some point, if you take the time, it'll be about 10 minutes on each temperament, that you learn about each of them. Because first of all, it's wonderful to try to identify your own temperament or temperament of other adults that are working with the child. Our job as adults is to really understand each of the temperaments and stay sort of here in the middle and call on these different qualities when we need them. So sometimes we need to be the cleric and really have the leadership and the energy for tasks. Sometimes we need the playful quality, the sanguine quality, the social butterfly quality. Sometimes we need to call on our empathetic, deeper feeling self that understands other people's suffering. And then the phlegmatic quality, we need to create rhythms and sort of a calm, steady beat in our homes. So our job is to understand all of these and pull on them as we need, pull on the gifts of each, and then work with the child that's in front of us so that they can transform their or come to the higher side of their temperament. All right, we will be going to the next part, which is you can click on the temperament you'd like to start with. Okay.